Perhaps just to begin with, if you could just give us a brief idea of the difference between neurophilosophy and perhaps traditional philosophy. What distinguishes neurophilosophy?
Well, neurophilosophy I think of as being at the interface between the traditional work and philosophy of mind and neuroscience. And it's really possible because of the extraordinary developments in neuroscience since about, let's say, 1950. And the discoveries have been such as to make it possible to see the implications for the grand old questions, even in the questions about the nature of knowledge and how we understand causality in the world and so forth. All of these questions can benefit from the results that are being discovered in neuroscience. And so I think traditionally we didn't know very much about the brain, and we didn't know very much about the details of how.
Oh, sorry. Ellie, you okay? Do you want to sit here?
Well, you can sit on your knee.
You could come and sit with me.
Sure. Why not? You can probably be a big help, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So an interview with your. With your youngest fan.
Yeah, that's nice.
So
until about 1950, there really wasn't enough information about the brain for people to see, even if they thought that probably all of cognition depended on the brain, they really couldn't quite see how. But after about 1950, with the advent of new techniques and so forth, we began to get big clues about the relationship between cognitive functions and the brain itself. And these just weren't opportunities that were available, for example, to Hume or to Kant. And I think Hume, you know, were he alive right now, would be a neurophilosopher.
Huh. And so what are the main directions that you see neurophilosophy heading in the next 10 to 15 years, especially with the new technologies that are becoming increasingly available?
Well, the questions about cognition that I think we're really interested in have to do with how it is that brains develop a coherent model of the external world, of where things are in the world, in other words, the nature of spatial knowledge, the nature of causal knowledge, how it's acquired, how it's updated, how the bodily skills that we acquire fit into that larger picture of the acquisition of social knowledge as well as physical knowledge about the nature of the world. So I think epistemology is one field that's really going to benefit. And I should just say, by the way, that it's not just neuroscience that's relevant here. I think of experimental psychology as part of the behavioral and brain sciences. So it's neuroscience at all of its many levels, networks, neurons, molecules, as well, of course, as behavior. So epistemology is one field where I think there will be a big impact. There already is some. And I think we will increasingly get an understanding of other things, such as the nature of decision making and how information is integrated by the brain so as to make a decision. And there's a lot of information that's integrated both from sensory stimuli but also from the internal state of the body, whether you're hungry or tired or fearful and so on, as well as information from long-term memory that is often brought to bear in decision making. And I think we'll come to really understand much more about how that works. I talked a little bit the other day about self-control and how I think that the idea of free will is really best kind of detached from the notion of self-control, and that we learn so much from psychology and neuroscience about the nature of self-control. And that will have a big effect on how we think of ourselves as agents maneuvering around the face of the planet.
Because your distinction between self-control and the traditional conception of free will, what kind of role does that leave for traditionally understood morality within neurophilosophy? Does it?
Well, I think that morality is really very, very complicated. And my talk this afternoon will be about the brain's platform that makes morality possible. So I think of morality as really having two parts. There's the biological element, and that's essentially the platform, and that's where most of my discussion will take place. And then there is, broadly speaking, politics. That is, the particular social practices and arrangements, taboos, conventions, and laws that various groups put together and modify and change over time, where those, to some degree, are meant to serve the stability and prosperity of the group. And so my own interest really is in the nature of the platform on which this superstructure of conventions and laws and practices is built.
Okay, and so maybe perhaps one last question, it's a personal question. How about language and...
Right.
In terms of, I mean, are you similar to the kind of the nativist camp, and that there's a definite part, a part of the brain that we can say is the home of language, or do you see a more of a multimodular?
Well, system? Yeah, I mean, it's a really good question, and one would have to say that not a lot is known about the processes that sustain language use. But the things that we have learned, I think, in the last year or so suggest, first of all, that it was implausible right from the beginning to suppose that there was a unique language organ that suddenly came into being with humans and had no precursor in other animals. I mean, everything we know about genetics, everything we know about evolution, the evolution of nervous systems, speaks against that. I mean, I guess miracles are always possible, but it's kind of a last resort hypothesis. The other thing is that one of the things we're learning is that the idea of modularity is really very suspect for almost all functions, and that many areas of the brain contribute to the good functioning of a certain capacity, whether it's visual perception or whether it's language. So let me give you an example from visual perception that tends to modify our ideas about modularity. So it's been noticed that people who are blind, and when they do something that requires a lot of high resolution input, like reading Braille, it's the visual cortex that's recruited. Now, that's a very interesting fact, because this is actually a somatosensory thing. That is, you're picking up signals via your hands, via the somatosensory system. And yet, it's in fact the visual cortex that seems to be recruited to do this very high resolution, very complicated style of processing. So one of the questions that, this was work done by Pascal Leone in Boston. So one of the questions he wanted to ask was, suppose I took normal seeing subjects and blindfolded them completely over a period of 1 week and allowed them to learn to read Braille. What would I see about their visual cortex? And what he found was that over time, it was the visual cortex that was recruited. The other thing is that in the visual cortex, now this is at a very different level of discussion, but in the visual cortex, we can see differences in the activity of a single neuron depending on, now we keep the visual stimulus constant, but we see differences depending on whether the animal is moving or not. So if the rat is running, you get a different signal from that same neuron than if the rat is stationary, granting that the stimulus remains exactly the same in both two cases. And this really tends to undermine the idea that what the brain consists of are these encapsulated separate modules that just, you know, do their business. And that now seems to be true of language as well. Some of the fMRI data shows that really quite widely distributed areas in both hemispheres are important for processing language. And that's something actually that shouldn't have been all that surprising, because work on infants had already shown something like that. So there are, it happens rarely, but it happens that an infant will have damage in the hemisphere that will require surgery, a hemispherectomy. And in a group of children that were tracked in San Diego, some had left hemispherectomies, some had right hemispherectomies. And the question is, what were their language milestones like? Did they learn language in the normal developmental way? And the answer is very interesting, and that is both kids learned language fairly normally. But interestingly, those with right hemispherectomies actually were somewhat slower in their language acquisition than those with left hemispherectomies, which is exactly the opposite of what you would predict if you thought that there was in the left hemisphere a module for language. So I think these data are suggesting that language is not confined to, not supported simply by a highly localized module, and that it may be part of a more general aspect of cognitive processing. But it remains puzzling why humans can acquire language in a way that does seem to be very different from what we know about chimpanzees. But of course, bear in mind that the divergence between humans and chimpanzees, evolutionarily speaking, is about 5 million years. Right? That's a long time. And although it was speculated by Chomsky and others that there was a mutation that suddenly produced language in just Homo sapiens about 40,000 years ago, that given that we can do the genome now of Neanderthals and do the genome of humans, now it looks like Neanderthals probably had the vocal apparatus to make a lot of sounds. Not as many as Homo sapiens can make, but many. And almost certainly, they did communicate to some degree using vocalizations.
So what may be missing is something, I mean, as Donald suggested, something like mimesis, the ability to imitate.
Possibly, although I think that was probably there too. My guess, and this is just speculation, is that very early humans probably didn't use that much in the way of language. They probably didn't have complicated garden path sentences. They obviously had a fairly limited conceptual repertoire because they didn't have very complicated artifacts. I mean, bear in mind that if anthropologists are right, and Homo sapiens have been around for about 250,000 years, we didn't get beyond using stone tools for about 200,000 years. Well, you know, that's a long time. We didn't even figure out how to take a stone and attach it to a stick and make a club for a long time. So, I mean, this is a point that's been made by many people, including Don Norman and many others, that we may seem to ourselves so discontinuous with our ancestors, partly because of the accumulation of culture. The culture makes us smart.
Thank you very much.
Okay,
and
thank you.
Thank you as well for your patience with the heckling.
That just kind of adds a little color,
I think. Heckling from the...
Yeah, it just adds a little color, doesn't it? What is his name?
Elijah.
So. Okay.
You're going to say goodbye.
Bye. Bye-bye.